Welcome. With this class, we would be starting a new series of NCERT. I have been receiving requests from many of the students regarding course to be covered for NCERT, for prelims as well as mains, and for other competitive exams as well. So what we'll do is, we'll start with class 6th onwards. We'll start first with geography. We'll cover chapter by chapter in each video. So today we'll be covering class 6 geography, the first chapter, Earth and the Solar System. Now, starting with the solar system, let's understand how this name came into existence. Now, solar is derived from sol, and sol in Roman means sun god. As a result, all the words that were formed from sol, like solar, denotes those related to sun. So, what we'll study in this chapter is the solar system, the major elements of solar system, and Earth in particular. Now, before we start with all these, let's understand a broad picture where most of the students are a bit confused. If I talk about, let's say, this is my first circle, which denotes universe, and this universe is made up of numerous galaxies. So it's made up of galaxies. Now, galaxies can be of many type. The galaxy in which we live is Milky Way, or we call it Akash Ganga. Within this galaxy, let's say this is the Milky Way galaxy, and within this galaxy we have the solar system. Or I could say in broad terms, you have the star systems that exist. And one such kind of star system, or one such kind of star, is Sun. And we have the solar system, which is the element of this universe. So you have, I'll repeat again, within the universe you'll have numerous galaxies. One such galaxy is Milky Way. Solar system is part of Milky Way. Now let's start with galaxy. When I talk about galaxy, I can say it's a system which includes stars, interstellar elements, and the dark matter as well. So Milky Way, as I said, is one such galaxy which contains the solar system. And you have the Hubble classification, which is used to identify various types of galaxies. Under the Hubble classification, you have three broad categories that are defined: the elliptical galaxies, the spiral galaxies, and lenticular galaxies. Of these, spiral galaxies are the most common. You have Andromeda as the most common example of a spiral galaxy, and Sombrero, which is a kind of unbarred spiral galaxy. So, spiral galaxies could again be divided into either unbarred or barred spiral galaxies. And you have Sombrero, which is an example of unbarred spiral galaxy. The most distant spiral, galaxy that was discovered or confirmed as of March 2016 is GNZ11. So that's considered as the most distant galaxy. Now, when we talk about within the galaxy, you have constellations. So before constellation, let's talk about the celestial bodies. So, celestial bodies include sun, moon, or objects in the night sky if we confine ourselves to the solar system. Now, celestial bodies can be of two types: one, those which emit light, and one, those which do not emit light. The bodies which emit light are classified as stars. The bodies which do not emit light, a good example could be planets. Now let's talk about the celestial bodies here. So here you have sun, which is the star, and around this star you have the numerous planets that revolve. So you have the 8 major planets that we talk about, and beyond the Kuiper belt you have the Pluto. We'll understand this in detail when we'll talk about the planets. Between Mars and Jupiter exist the asteroids, which is a kind of belt of small rocks that exist between Mars and Jupiter. Now, Sun is one kind of star. We have numerous stars that are present into the present on the in the solar system, or the kind of star systems we have, and the arrangement is defined in a certain manner, which is known as constellation. The north star is also known as the pole star, and it indicates the north direction. When we talk about planet, the word planet was discovered by Greeks, and it was named as Planetai. The Planetai in Greek means wanderers. So these objects were considered as wandering into the sky when we look at. Now, when we talk about constellations, as I said, there are officially 88 constellations that exist. This was declared by the International Astronomical Unit. Of these, 12 are the constellations based on which you have the 12 zodiac signs, and these are the shapes of the 12 major constellations, that is Aquarius, Aries, Cancer, Capricorn, so on. So besides that, you have the Ursa Major and Ursa Minor, which are the two major constellations that exist. Now, the yellow section of the Ursa Major is also known as the Big Dipper or the Big Bear. This is a shape of a bear, so it forms the shape of the bear, so it's known as also known as Big Bear. And these stars form the Saptarishi Mandal, or the seven stars which form the Saptarishi Mandal, as we call it in Hindi. Now, beyond this you have the tail, and at the tail you have the brightest star, which is known as Alioth. And this is the brightest star in the Ursa Major. However, you have Polaris, which is the brightest star in the Ursa Minor and also considered as one of the brightest stars. So this is about the constellation. Now moving on, you have the classification for planets. Now most of the references, including NCERT, cite Pluto as a planet. However, under recent discoveries, it has been declared that Pluto is not a planet, rather it is a dwarf planet, or I could say it's a planetoid. Now let's understand first the eight major planets, and then we'll move on to Pluto in particular. Now the planet system is classified into two, the terrestrial planets and the Jovian planets. Jovian means Jupiter-like, which is huge. So you have the terrestrial planets, which are considered up to Mars, that is closest to the Sun is Mercury. Then you have Venus, Earth and Mars. So Earth is third closest to the Sun, but fifth largest in mass. And you have these four planets, which are considered as terrestrial planets. These are small and rocky in nature. However, you have Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus and Neptune, which are giant planets. They are large and are considered to be as low density planets. However, within these Jovian planets, or I could say the giant planets, you have further two classifications. The Jupiter and Saturn are considered mainly gas planets. However, Uranus and Neptune are basically considered ice planets. So you have ice, which is predominant in Uranus and Neptune. However, it is gas that is predominant in Jupiter and Saturn. Now, beyond Neptune, you have a kind of belt which is known as Kuiper belt. The scientists previously discovered a kind of Oort cloud in this region, and this was the region where they talked about numerous comets that exist. However, later on, Kuiper discovered a belt which was known as Kuiper belt that exists beyond Neptune. And this belt is a belt of belt of ice that exists. And within this Kuiper belt, they have recently discovered planet 9. And this planet 9 is considered to be 10 times the mass of Earth and 5000 the times of mass of the Pluto. Now, under the recent definitions, they have declared that since Pluto has left the orbit of the Sun, it is not considered as a planet anymore. Again, it is very small in size. It is beyond the Kuiper belt that exists, and therefore it is considered as a dwarf planet or a planetoid. Other planetoids include Ceres and Eris. Now, When there was an official classification going on to understand which could be considered, what could be considered as a planet, they explained that a planet must have 27% more mass as compared to Pluto, then only it would be officially declared as a planet. So any body, any celestial body having a mass of 27% more as compared to Pluto would be considered as a planet, and as a result Pluto is no more considered a planet. It is a dwarf planet or a planetoid. I repeat again. Now Ceres is one of the largest objects in the asteroids, and asteroids, as I said, is a belt between Mars and Jupiter, and Ceres is also considered as a dwarf planet. The another important dwarf planet that was discovered is Eris. It was discovered in 2003, hence it is named as 2003 UB313, and it is considered as the 10th planet or the largest dwarf planet which is discovered till date. As I said, you have the Kuiper belt, and before the Kuiper belt it was known as Oort cloud, and this Oort cloud was considered to be made up of ice, which is composed mainly of ammonia, methane and water. And later on it was discovered that this Kuiper belt, which exists beyond Neptune, is similar in many respects to the asteroid belt that exists between Mars and Jupiter. So the belt between Mars and Jupiter, that is the asteroid belt, is very much similar to that beyond the Neptune, and that is known as the Kuiper belt. Now understanding the Earth, when we talk about Earth, it's important to first understand the shape of the Earth. The shape of the Earth is not a perfect sphere. It is an oblate spheroid shape, as we say, or it is geoid in nature. Now what's the difference? So you have the map of the Earth here. If you look to this map closely, you will see that you have the polar diameter and the equatorial diameter, and there is a difference between the equatorial diameter, which is 12756, and you have the polar diameter, which is 121714, that is, it is 42 kilometers more in width as compared to height, if I say that in simple words. So you have, I can say it is flatter at the poles, and since it's flatter at the poles, we call this shape as an oblate spheroid, not a perfect sphere. As I mentioned, it's third nearest to the sun, fifth largest planet. It has an age of around 4.54 billion years old. Now looking on, moving on to the major chemical composition. If I talk about the chemical composition of the crust of the Earth, as we know, the Earth is made up of crust, core and mantle. So you have the crust, which is the outermost layer. Then you have the layer which is known as mantle, and the innermost part which is known as the core of the Earth. The outermost crust, you have maximum proportion of silica, followed by aluminium, followed by lime. So you have highest proportion in terms of silica. When we talk about the mass of the Earth, the whole Earth with its mass, you have iron, which is highest at 32%, then followed by oxygen and silicon. The crust itself, the outer crust, which is silica and alumina, but both of these compounds have oxygen in them. So I can say the crust is made up of 47% of oxygen. Now there are two basic phenomena that work for the Earth. One is rotation and another is revolution. Rotation means spinning on its axis, and revolution means taking one complete round around the sun. So you have the sun, and the one complete round that the Earth takes around the sun is known as revolution. Revolution governs the seasons. However, rotation, which is spinning on its axis, which will govern the day and night phenomena. Now, when it's rotating, when it's revolving around the sun, so as I said, the path is not spherical again, it's a kind of elliptical path. So at some point, it is closest to the Earth, the other point, it is farthest from the Earth. The point that is closest to the Earth is 3rd January, it's in and around 3rd January, and farthest from the Earth is around, Sun is around 4th July. Now the region where it's closest to the Earth is known as perihelion. Helion means sun, and peri, a good way to remember I can say is, if you remember this in Hindi, P for peri and P for pass, and pass means close. So peri means the region closest to the sun. On the other hand, you have aphelion, which is the region farthest from the sun, or the region where you have Earth at a farthest distance from the sun. So you have perihelion and aphelion that you must know here. Now what we are discussing is a kind of bit expansion of what is there in a class 6 NCERT. So I am trying to cover it in a kind of bit detail. Now the next is moon. Now when we talk about moon, moon is one of the natural satellites of Earth. There are many moons that exist. The most important, or I could say the largest moon of the solar system, is the moon of Jupiter, which is known as Ganymede. Then you have the second largest moon of the solar system, which is the moon of Saturn, which is known as Titan. And Earth's moon, that's what we call as moon itself, is the fifth largest natural satellite. Now moon's diameter is 1/4 that of the Earth. The gravitational attraction between Earth and moon leads to tidal phenomena. It's at a distance of 384,400 kilometers from the Earth. Now there are two ways in which we define months as per the lunar calendar. You have the sidereal month and the synodic month. Now sidereal months are with respect to the star. So you have one complete revolution with respect to the star, and that completes in 27.32 days. However, if we talk about the synodic month, it is with respect to the sun. So it's time taken by the moon to reach the same visual phase. I can say a similar phase where moon, earth and sun are in a similar alignment each time. And therefore, since you are trying to align them at a similar level, it takes much more than the sidereal month. So you have the synodic month that exists at 29.53 days. So you must be clear about sidereal month and synodic month. And now recently there have been various missions to moon. India's first mission was known as Chandrayaan 1. The second is getting ready, which is Chandrayaan 2. Then you have the recent project, which is Team Indus, which aims that by 2018 India will hoist tricolor on 26 January of 2018 by Team Indus, which is a kind of unmanned spacecraft which will be released to moon, or I could say a robotic spacecraft which would be released to moon. Now besides these, you have some other important terms that you must have heard off and on. So the first is asteroid. As I said, asteroid is small rocks that exist between Mars and Jupiter. And they are small rocky elements. The largest of the asteroid is Cirrus, and which is one of the dwarf planets as we discussed. Then you have meteoroids. Meteoroids are small particles that move around the sun, and they can drop onto the Earth. When they drop on the Earth, there is friction that is produced, and because of the friction there is a flash of light that is generated when a meteorite hits the Earth. The next is comets. Comets are the ice bodies which move due to solar radiations and the solar wind, and as a result they have a kind of tail that exists, and that tail always points away from sun. And last is you have the pulsars. These are highly magnetized rotating bodies, or rotating neutron stars in better language if I say, and they emit a beam of electromagnetic radiations, and those are known as pulsars. So these are other commonly used terms when we talk about the solar system in general. So this was the first chapter of the NCERT. We'll be covering the next chapters in the further lectures. As I said, these what we are covering would be a kind of bit detail from what exists exactly in the NCERT book. So it would help you through your competitive examinations. You can subscribe to our channel for further updates on NCERTs. Have a good day ahead.